amount of jobs that you actually have with the Cherokee Chiefs.
There's a lot involved in doing this. I mean, our budget for Cherokee is over $50,000 each year to have the organization play hockey, and that includes banquets and awards and different stuff. So I saw some needs, not that the people that were involved were doing it wrong, but I saw ways we could maybe help better this organization. I didn't become president until, I guess, probably 2009 or so, but I was a vice president for a number of years, you know. So, you know, we used to have meetings at one of the coaches' house, you know, like it was four or five of us and get together and see what we could do. And, you know, we always look for new ideas of how to, you know, make it more fun for the kids, make them more enjoyable, but also at the same time develop hockey players so that they can, we can get the most potential out of them. So, you know, the president's job has got a lot of things going on. There's a lot to look out for. It might seem like, for the average person, it's like, oh, you show up to a game, you play, and you go home, but there's a lot to get to that point. You know, scheduling practice slots throughout the year, scheduling, getting games scheduled, finding events to do, fun events for the kids to get involved with. We go over to the Flyers game every year. So there's a lot that goes on to make it, and it's all timely things. You know, you can't order practice, you know, a week before the season starts. You've got to get that 4 or 5 months in advance to book your times, because even with all the rinks that are built around here today, there's not enough ice time for these kids. So it's a long process, but we've got a pretty good system now, and it seems to work. You know, we have our own, I have to be able to take my coach's hat off. You know, if we have a player that, let's say the parents aren't paying, and they're behind, and you know, this organization runs on the parents' money. That's what it really does. That's how we feed us. We don't make money.
Oh, you guys don't have just like a little tree that just keeps it in?
No, the tree's got cut down. So, but we need money at certain times. The league is asking for their money. The rinks are asking for their money. The referees get paid every game, you know, and there's certain things we have to do. So it makes it difficult, because what do I do when I have a player who I, you know, really enjoy coaching? He's a good kid. He works hard. And he's an important part of our team, and then, you know, I find out that, you know, we're not getting money into the organization. Do you shut the kid down? Or, you know, and we have multiple conversations with the parents, you know, and then people have, you know, life gets in the way. You know, people get divorced and they lose their jobs and things happen so we're very understanding about that. We try to work with people, but in the meantime, you know, we have to pay the league by the end of the year,
right,
or you can't play in the playoffs. So we've got goals that we need to set for people so that they can pay us and we can move on. But it's tough at times. There's times where, you know, we didn't get much response back.
The hard part is when you're the president, you're worried about not just the one team. You're also worried about, you know, every single player that's in the organization and how everything comes together with that, right? Like,
I'm worried about 45 players.
Right.
You know, and as a coach, I'm worried about 17 players.
Right. And as a parent, you're worried about one player.
Well, exactly. So it's... We've certainly been fortunate to have some good players come through this program, but I think you have to develop the program that they want to come to also, too. I think you have to make sure that there's been a lot of kids throughout the years that live in this area here that never played high school hockey because they just said, it's the Goon League, and it's not travel, it's not as good as, and I never compare the two. I mean, we will talk about that, I'm sure, comparing high school and travel, but you have to build something that they want to come to.
Right.
Because there are just kids who will say, I mean, I've seen kids have come in their senior year, not necessarily at Cherokee, but other teams in the league, and said, oh my God, this was so much fun. Why didn't I play the other 3 years? And it's a shame, because that falls on what I think is our responsibility as an organization to make sure we reach out to players and make sure they see what we're doing here and how we're developing players and how we're, you know, understanding that travel comes first in a lot of senses, and that we will take that step back to that. Because some people think, oh, you're going to force me to come here and I'm going to miss my travel thing, and it's not like that. So for us, you know, as a pure team and only Marlton kids, you know, we don't have a selection of players like travel does, where you get to pick from kids from all over the place. So we have to rely on, we have a good street hockey program in Marlton, and we've built a pretty good middle school program in at Cherokee, so that our feeder program is constantly there, and we've got some great people down there doing great things with coaches, and the organization is doing good things to keep these kids coming in. You know, are we lucky? We're probably lucky in some sense. We get some kids, but we make sure that there's a lot of AAA kids that never played high school hockey and they don't want to.
Right.
But we made sure that our kids saw some kind of a benefit of it. If you want to compare the two, I mean, right now, I mean, your mom and dad goes to your travel games and there's 200 people of your classmates and friends and girls that come to the high school games that make it a great experience. And there's no doubt that high school's more fun than travel. We've had to the point where we've had to sit down with the player and their parents and have a conversation about, we're not upset with your son because he's not very good. We're not upset with him because he can't score 25 goals in this league. We're not upset with him because he, you know, does certain things right or wrong. We're upset because the one thing he can control, and that's effort. Cherokee, I mean, if you have an issue with how much your kid's playing, or why has he not made this team over this team, as a coach, if you don't have those answers, then there's something wrong.
Right.
And I say, as the president of the club, if you go to a coach and he doesn't, I think I've already said this, if you go to him and he doesn't have a good answer,
right,
then we need to have that conversation and we'll solve the problem. But all the kids should play. They should get fairly equal playing time.
Right.
Unless the kid is just not given an effort. Then there's going to be a reason why he sat down, and the coach will certainly have that answer. But I think you have to consistently play these kids so they get better. And like I said, maybe 25% of our organization doesn't play travel hockey. So these kids are, how much ice time are they really getting?
Right.
So that hour that we have them has to be focused. What I also say about the parents is encourage your kids. This should be fun for them. This is the time of their life where you can't get back.
Right.
I think all of us have all said at one time or another, I'd love to go back to high school now. With what I knew now, I knew back then,
right,
geez, how things would have been different. But you have to encourage your kids. We try to, at each practice, try to get the kid to take a step forward, whether it be. Exactly. And that's why you learn. You don't learn by doing everything right. You learn by making mistakes. And then the thing is, what we don't like is when you consistently do the same mistake you've been talked to about 10 times. So that might be a situation where, you know, maybe it's not your night tonight. I mean, I had a player just the other night that just, he's a great player. And he just didn't have a good night.
Right.
We had to recognize that as coaches. And so we changed the lines up a little bit. We put him someplace else. And it's not going to change. You're going to put him right back where he was and get him to, you know, fell off that horse, get back on the horse, and let's go again. If you have a question about something, just come up and ask the coach after the game. But if you're heated, wait 24 hours and then give him a call. And a lot of times you'll see that in that 24 hours you go, you know what, it wasn't as bad as I thought. I was just mad. I had a bad day at work. And, you know, I saw my kid wasn't getting the ice time, or he did a few things wrong, and he got a bad penalty or something like that. You know, why did he get a 2-10 or something? So I think if you think about it a little bit, most likely you won't even call the coach the next day. But if you still have an issue, let's discuss it. And let's, like I said, there's always a solution to the problem. Maybe you don't know some of the things that's going on. You know, our biggest concern sometimes is the players on the bench, how they handle themselves there.
Right.
And kids, and we've had kids in the past that didn't handle themselves well on the bench. And that can be so disruptive to a team. And it's like a cancer, you know, it spreads, you know. Well, if he can yell, why can't I yell? And if he can yell, then how come I can't? So it gets to be, we had a couple of years where we were very successful. We had problems on our bench.
Mm-hmm.
And that's got to be nipped in the bud. We've had a good run here. Most of our JV kids would be very successful in other varsity teams.
Right.
But you're playing on one of the better teams in the league, and you have to knock somebody down to get onto that squad. And we give you every opportunity to do that through the spring league, through camps, and up until all the tryouts, the four tryouts, to show us that. You know, the problem is there's some kids that aren't good tryout players.
Right.
And there's some kids that look great in tryouts and aren't great in games. And that's what we utilize the spring league for, the 10 games there, to see them in game-type situations where, how are they going to react when it comes into a situation where the other team's running everybody, and
right,
how are they going to handle that? How are they going to handle the speed of another team? How are they going to handle? In tryouts, if you're just going down the ice and carrying a puck, you can look great.
Right.
You know, so it's a lot of work and a lot of time, and that's why people go, oh, spring is worthless. For the coaches, it's a great time to really see the kids, how they play. For players, you know, like I said, we have practice. It's one day a week for high school. So we have 1 hour to try to develop all these kids. And it's just really not enough time. we're hoping that if they are playing travel, they're developing there and they're getting on the ice more, which they certainly do. Some of our kids play 7 days a week. So for them, it's what are you doing away from the rink to better yourself?
Right.
And, you know, I'll recommend places like I do here. And we've had conversations about this. Just because I recommend you to come to a certain place to train,
right,
doesn't mean you're going to make the top team.
Right.
It will give you help and it will give you an opportunity to possibly make the better team. But it's not, it's no guarantee. I mean, it's how you, when you come here, how hard are you working?
Right.
Are you giving 100% here? And if you give 100% here, that'll probably translate to the ice. If you get 100% on the ice, you've got every chance to make the top team. But there's no guarantees, and like in hockey, like in life, you know, no matter what you do. But it's really important that the kids, there's plenty of places to go outside of the ice rink. As far as other organizations and teams, you know, I mean, it's, I think there has to be a stability in your organization. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, everybody says change is good. I agree with that in some things, but if you have different parents coming in to run the organization every year, and every 1 or 2 years you're changing them up and you've got new ideas, which is not a bad thing, but sometimes they're not great ideas, or they've never done it before, or they've never failed.
Or the idea might have been a good idea, but it never, you never let it develop.
Right.
Right. So it takes more than a year to 2 years to develop a program.
You're not going to change something and overnight.
Right.
It's a success.
And then if you change it again after 2 years, then now you're just...
If a new person comes in and goes, oh, I don't like that, I'm going back to the old way. I think we've been lucky to have a lot of people stay on our board, and coach has been around for years, and we have a good understanding of how we want to do it. And we're not always right, but we've learned over those years. This is my 20th year. We've made mistakes. And we've learned from those and we moved on. And then we try to pass them down to our own players.
Right.
You know, this didn't work before, probably won't work again.
Right.
We can try it, but let's eliminate the mistakes and try to get it in the right path, going, you know, in the right direction right away.
Right.
So it's, I think that's what you'll see, like a team like Eastern, who was combined with Cherry Hill, East and West, for a number of years there. And they finally broke off and they won a championship. First year varsity level, tremendous,
right.
And now they've built it up to where they have three teams.
Right.
And all of a sudden, 4 years ago they couldn't field a team, and all of a sudden I think there's a good stability in that organization. There, people running it, and a constant thing. And like you said, change some things, but also building on that and keeping that going. So, how are you going to adapt to getting to being? You were the big fish in the little pond.
Right.
And now all of a sudden you're the little fish in the big pond when you get to the juniors level. And now instead of there only being 4 or 5 kids that are at your level, there's 2,500 kids at your level.
Right.
And how are you going to separate yourself from the competition? And we have this conversation with the players all the time and the parents, because it's important. You know, if you're one of 2,500 now, how are you going to stand out?
Right.
You're going to be that vocal guy. You're going to be the leader. You're going to be the, you know, the guy that kind of separates himself from the rest of that competition, because your skill levels are very similar at this point. So that's a transition for kids, even kids coming from middle school to high school. They might have been the big fish in the middle school.
Right.
Now you're coming and you're playing against, you're a freshman, and you're playing against a kid that's got a beard and he's been driving for a year.
Right.
You know, how are you going to handle that?
Right.
He's, you know, 6'1", 195 pounds, and you're 5'1", you know, 127 pounds.
Right.
How are you going to adapt to that? And the way you handle that, both physically and mentally, is how you're gonna, is, you know, it's gonna show them what you're